When I think about the Lord, how he saved me,
yes,
how he raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he healed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, how he picked me up and turned me around, how he placed my feet on solid ground. When I think about the Lord, how he saved me, how he raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he healed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, how he picked me up and turned me around, how he placed my feet on solid ground, makes me wanna shout, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory, all the honor and all the praise. Makes me wanna shout, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. When I think about the Lord, how he saved me,
I've been set free. I've been set free.
degree. The Son of God hanging on a hill when hell was my destiny. The crowd was shouting, crucify. It could have come from these lips of mine. The dirty shame was killing me. It would take a miracle to wash me clean. Then I read the red letters, and the ground began to shake.
Your voice, you have led me through the fire. darkest night. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God.
Ago this past Thursday, got out of my car and I walked into a conference room with the devil. With every step I took, he told me, "You have sealed your fate. You're done preaching. You've burnt the only bridge that you had. You'll never see what you used to see. This is it." That same devil, we had church. He wasn't nowhere to be found during church. But as soon as I walked out the room, he walked with me again. And he kept telling me days like today would never come. We wouldn't make it a year. We made it a year. He said, "You wouldn't make it 2 years. He said, "You never find a building." Then when we outgrew that one, he said, "You never find another building." And right now he's trying to tell me that we ain't going to find the next one.
Shut him up.
All I want to say is, where are you at now? Because he ain't in here right now. The goodness of God has fell in this place, and we now see how good God's been to us. How many's thankful from a conference room to the middle of this place? God has built something. God has encouraged some people. God has saved some people. Lives have been changed because the devil tried to ride with us once, but Jesus ain't never left our side one time. Amen. I'm thankful today that I have somebody like him to work with me. Amen. Because I'm a mess at the best. Amen. Let's sing it one more time. Can y'all cue it up for my girl? I'm going to pay her $50 for just singing it twice today.
Me too. Me too. Turn it up.
How about you think about how good God's been to you for a minute, and all those that anger, frustration, bitterness, let it roll away. Give it back to the devil today.
For your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up,
yes,
until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful.
Yes.
And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your voice, you have led me through fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God.
name, church.
Amen.
Amen. Great job, Father. Great job,
Father. Amen.
I remember standing, closing the service down. It was either the first Sunday or the second Sunday. And Owen's family had been there. And here's Jessica and Anthony, probably, 21 at the most, 22-ish, 15, 16 years old, something like that. I looked. Four kids ago, he can't remember that far back, understandably. Little Gracie, her little blonde curls, and Miss Emma in the basket. And they shook my hand, and I said, I hope you enjoyed yourself. And they said, we'll be back. And that thrilled me. And when they walked away, the devil said, you're going to mess that up. You're going to mess that up. Mm-hmm. And he's right. I would have if I had ever gotten God's way. Mm-hmm. He's been faithful.
Yeah. Amen. Bless your heart. Sure.
Amen. Amen.
I don't do it enough. I just
want to
praise the Lord for
everything
he's done
in my life. Yes, amen. Yes, amen. Come on, church. Come on, church. Don't sit on it. Change your name to Bennett because you ain't in it. Maybe you're with it.
Man. Yeah, I got it. Yesterday was fun. We got to hang out with the kids and play with them. It was a dream come true. Something we've been talking about for a long time, being able to do, and just never pulled the trigger. Waited on someone else whenever we should have been doing it. And all those kids playing, and I took them upstairs and was teaching a lesson. I talked to I like the Three Little Pigs. It's one of my favorite stories growing up. So I kind of turned that into a Bible story. And I was talking about them in the last house. The wolf was sitting there blowing on the house as hard as he could, but he couldn't get in. And there those three little pigs is. And I said, and they're just sitting in there eating bacon and ham and sausage. Tegan's eyes went, boom, like she got it. And the pigs were eating ham and eggs and bacon and sausage. It was awesome. And my girl Harmony goes, and biscuits. And I was like, that's my girl right there. I love it. I'm thankful for what God's done in this church this morning. I'm looking forward to what he continues to do. One of my very best friends in all the world, when I started thinking about, well, should I preach this one? And I said, nah, I'm just going to sit back and enjoy it and think of just how good God's been. And while I'm doing that, I wanted to get one of y'all's, it seems like it's one of your favorite preachers to come and just don't hold back. Hey, listen, they're used to it. Don't worry about the time. We ain't having church tonight. I'm giving them the night off. So we're just going to go ahead and have church right now. And if you get hungry, go get you something. Come back across the street. McDonald's will get you in and out really quickly. Now, Starbucks, depending on the line, I don't know. Brother Jeremy, come on up and preach for us.
Yeah, this is all right.
On all right? Amen. Am I on all right? Good deal. How about now? Can you hear me? Yeah, I had one church tell me. I had one church tell me, they said, make sure you keep that mic down a little bit lower. Your beard keeps on hitting it. Hey, but amen. Britt was supposed to have been with me this morning, but our baby, Lemmy, he had a little bit of a fever throughout the night, so she kept him home today. And we was going to sing, but I believe we would have messed up everything God already had ordained. And I am thankful that I get to be here with y'all, with you guys. I love you guys. I love this church. Y'all have always been, your pastor's always been a friend to me, him and his wife, Sid. And Sydney, I'm sorry, I should say Sydney. I should be more respectful, shouldn't I? And so anyways, they've always been my friends, and I love them. And it's an honor to get to be here on this special day. I can remember when it started down there at the hotel conference room. What was it? Holiday Inn? Country Inn and Suites. They got a good continental breakfast, though, didn't they?
Yeah, we set up.
That's what I'm talking about. I've done that before. We started a church, and then we was meeting in the Civic Center. We love telling everybody, say, we come to church with us. We got the biggest building in Charleston. Come and meet with us. And they didn't realize it was like the closet way up in the back is what we leased out with about 30 people that was faithful. Sometimes that's all you need, and God just does the rest. So, man, I'm thankful. I'll tell you what, I pray that just group that's in here this morning, there's a bunch of you that's already in. You enjoy being here. You like being here, so you're active here, and God's working in your heart, and He's doing a great work through you and with you, and you love this place, and you love watching it grow and do things. Then there's some of you that you're still on the outside of this thing. You need to get in. And you need to just experience what God has for you. You're living a life that's half empty right now. And you need to jump on in this thing. And then once you jump in on this thing, let God blow the walls out of this place, give you a bigger building and have a bigger outreach and everything else. And just watch what God can do. It's amazing what He can do. It's amazing what He can do. I ain't going to preach up. That's pretty good. Somebody give me some points, I'll give it a shot. But amen. If you've got your Bible, turn over with me. I'm going to give you what the Lord has on my heart. He gave this to me. I didn't know I was going to preach it this morning, but He gave it to me a few days ago. I was going to try to polish it up a little better, but it's just I can't get away from this thought this morning. And so if you turn over with me in your Bible to Ecclesiastes chapter 3, Ecclesiastes chapter 3. And it's over there right behind Proverbs and tucked in between the Song of Solomon and Proverbs. And just while you're turning there, I'll give you a little thought on it. Nobody really knows who wrote Ecclesiastes, but it is believed. Historians and theologians believe that it was Solomon, which only makes sense because it is tucked between Song of Solomon and Proverbs. So it's there's a lot of good reading in here, and I love what my old King James Bible, the way that it's worded in here. It touches my heart because I'm a preacher, and it starts right off the bat in chapter 1. It says, in the words of the preacher. So it touches our hearts, don't it, Corey? Because we love people. We don't want to see people mess up and make a mess. And there's some words that we try to convey, and the same God that gave that preacher words is the same God that looks at us and gives us words today. Amen. I'm glad He's faithful. I'm glad He still uses. I said all that to give you time to get to Ecclesiastes chapter 3. How many of you is there now? Amen. Let's pray. God, we love You. God, we thank You for a time to get to be in church this morning. God, touch us and be with us. God, I ask You, Lord, just to get me out of the way. God, we want to know You and Your presence and all Your fullness and all Your glory this morning. God, they didn't come to hear me. They come to hear You. So God, get me out of the way. Just use me as a vessel. Use me as a tool. Speak through me, Lord. May You get all the glory this morning. We sure love You. Appreciate You. Thank You for coming and visiting with us throughout this whole service, through the testimonies, God. Lord, through the song service, oh my God, I love it whenever you're there, God, you're welcomed. And you come down and you visit with us for a little while. Thank you for stopping by. I ask you just to keep on visiting with us throughout the end of this service. God, bless this church. God, bless them right here where they're at. I ask you to use them as a lighthouse, dear God. Many, many people have walked through the doors and left changed, God. And I ask you, Lord, not only to let that keep happening, dear God, and keep using Corey in this church, Lord, to reach lost souls, Lord, to encourage saints, but God, I'm begging you, Lord, just bless them. Bless them, God. Bust the walls out, Lord. Make this place bigger for your glory. God, do something great for this church. We love you. And in your name, amen. The Bible says, first of all, in chapter 3, to everything there is a season. And I guess what I really want to convey to you this morning, just passing through, I'm going to put this out here so I can see what time it is. I know I'm not supposed to pay no attention. Man, I can't help but pay attention now. My belly told me it was 12 o'clock before I looked down and saw that. Amen. But to everything, there is a season. I just want to stop for this morning and just for a little while, and you can look at your life, at everything that's happened, everything that's taken place, everything that's transpired. And I'm telling you, the truth of the matter is this, no matter how bad it was, no matter how difficult the thing was or how great the thing was, you can look back now and it's just a snap of a finger. You know why? Because it's just a season. Now, I'm going to tell you, I'm going to throw this little rabbit trail in here because I was thinking, I was so thankful that I felt God's presence this morning. As soon as we leave out of here, and as soon as we hit them doors, I'm not trying to be a Debbie Downer or negative Nancy or anything else, but you know he's waiting outside to try to discourage you. Whatever it was that you was able to drop for a little while inside of here and get in the presence of God, he's waiting out there with it to try to mess you up this morning. But listen, can I tell you this morning that whatever we go through, whatever we have going on, it's just a season. I'm sure you could ask the preacher over here, say, Corey, whenever you first walked in to that empty conference room and you just thought, this don't look like a church, it don't feel like a church, it just seems a whole lot different than what we're used to and everything else. Can God, and sure enough, in the first service, God moved in and God did a work. And you look at that time, what seemed like was just going to be forever before you found yourself planted. I remember I met in the Civic Center for 3 years carrying equipment up in there, sound equipment, setting up and everything else before God finally gave us a place. And I just remember this has taken forever, but I look back now and it's gone, it's over, it's past, and it was just a season. Can I tell you, I don't know what you're dealing with this morning. I don't know what you have going on in your life this morning. I don't know what terrible issues you have. I don't know what great issues you have. But can I tell you for just a simple thought this morning that this is just a season. And this world ain't our home. We're just a passing through. And I don't know about you, but if you're saved and you're a child of God this morning, you better roll up your rubber boots and get ready to walk through this thing, because we're getting ready to walk through some mud and some mud and Samara, and it's going to feel like it's about to take us down. But can I tell you, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I won't fear no evil, for he is with me, and he's riding his staff. They comfort me this morning, and I'm telling you, you can continue to walk through that dark valley as a child of God, and on the other side, you'll be able to look by and can say, it was just a season. The flood was just a season. The cancer could have been just a season. The wayward child could have been just a season. The addiction could have just been a season. But can I tell you that on the other side of trusting God and knowing that my life is in His hands and looking back and say, yeah, it was a little bad. It was a little messy. But look where I am now by the provisions of God. It was just a season in my life. And so you look back and you say, well, what's he calling a season? What's he calling a season right here? Well, in chapter 1, you can stay right there where you're at. But in chapter 1, it says, the words of the preacher, the son of David, king of Jerusalem, vanity of vanities, saith the preacher, vanity of vanities, all is vanity. And do you want to know what he's saying right there? You want to know what he's saying when he says that word, vanity of vanities, all is vanities. That word vanity means emptiness. And so when we start putting the scripture in perspective of what, oh, now it's making sense. And you look back and the preacher's shouting, emptiness, emptiness, emptiness is all around us. You better be careful. You better be careful because the season that you're walking through, or the season you might get ready to walk into, or the season you're walking out of, it could possibly be great emptiness, just something to make you turn your head for a little bit to mess you up. God's got a plan. God's got a path. God's got a way. Keep trusting in God and everything's going to be fine. Everything's going to be all right. I know sometimes it may be uncomfortable. I know sometimes it may seem like it's tough, but can I tell you to keep your eyes on the Savior? Keep your eyes and hide behind the cross. Keep your eyes on Him. Don't look to the left. Don't look to the right, but keep trusting in Him, because all there is, the preacher's trying to tell you this morning, that it's vanity and all emptiness. Nothing to satisfy your soul like God can this morning. You know why in this very moment that our hearts are so full this morning, Wes? Chris, Wes, my friend, my brother. Do you know the reason why our hearts are so full? Listening to this wonderful little girl just proclaim that God is good this morning. It's because we're sitting and we're basking in the goodness of God this morning, and we're celebrating 9 years of wonderful bliss right here inside of this church this morning. And because I'm telling you that we found whenever we let God into our life and we let Him fill us up, that we're not empty like we was before. You know, sitting on the outside, now listen to me, my peoples, that the glass is half full this morning. When you're sitting on the outside, life is full of vanity. And if you're not careful, that emptiness that you're feeling, that vanity, that emptiness this morning, if you ain't careful, if you don't let the Lord fill that up inside of your life, the devil's going to be quick as soon as you walk out the doors to try to fill it with something to discourage you and take you down and take you out. He goes on to say that, listen, vanity of vanities, all is vanity. It's full of emptiness. What's it full of emptiness? The preacher said this. Well, I've experienced it all, is what the preacher says right here in the Bible. He goes on to tell us and declare in chapter 3 what all it is, what all the emptiness is. And he says this, to everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under the heaven. A time to be born. And if you notice, he's given you A to Z. There is no middle ground in what he's giving you. He's giving you the best and he's giving you the worst of every situation as he gives you the list of all the vanities, the emptiness that he's talking about inside of the Word today. He says there's a time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck up that which is planted. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to break down and a time to build up. He said there's a time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. There's a time to get and then there's a time to lose. A time to keep and a time to cast away. A time to rend and then there's a time to sow. There's a time to keep silence and then there's a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time of war and a time of peace. And what the preacher says in chapter 3 is I've experienced this in my life, that whenever I'm telling you that life is full of emptiness, I have tried to fill that emptiness with this. I've tried to fill it with this, the planning, the killing, the this, the that, or whatever it may be. I've tried to fill it and nothing has been able to sustain me. It's all vanity. It's all emptiness. And at the end of all of this list that he said, I have done, I've been through, after all of this stuff that I've gone through, I still find myself wondering, what is the purpose and why do I feel so empty? If we skip then, I'm just giving you a little bit of history behind what we've got going on in the Ecclesiastes chapter 3. The preacher don't just leave us off right there, but in chapter 12, he goes on to say this. He gives us the answer at the very end of chapter 12 of what is the purpose in our life this morning. And in the very last chapter, in the next last two verses, he said this in 12 and 13, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. You fear God. You keep His commandments. For this is the whole duty of man. This is the whole. We have made the will of God in our life such a complicated thing. We have somehow talked ourselves into that if we follow God and if we chase after Him, then oh my goodness, He's going to make us a missionary and send us to Africa. He's going to do something crazy, and that's not anything I want to do. Well, as much as you're not ready to go to Africa, maybe the Africans aren't ready for you to be there. And it's just not your will for you to be there in that place because God hasn't willed it in your life. And we try to complicate it and we make God's will so messy in our life. But can I tell you what the will of God truly is in our life this morning? It's just taking time to please Him. Doing what pleases Him. That's it. It's so simple. This little girl that was singing this morning, you thought, oh, that's so cute. And we clap for her and we say, go on and stuff like that. Do you know that with every breath and with every word that she was singing out this morning, that little girl was in the middle of the will of God as much as the preacher that started the church, as much as the choir director that sang. It don't take much to be in the will of God this morning. It just takes a heart that says, I just want to please the Lord. Whether it's going out into the rehab clinics and preaching to those, whether it's standing at the door and welcome as they come inside the door, it's just a heart that's willing to want to please the Lord. It's not some crazy missionary trip. It's not some crazy this or that. Nobody's telling you to be in the will of God this morning that you have to announce your call to preach and find yourself over on the streets of Charleston by noon today because it's already past noon, by 1300 today. But can I tell you, it's all it is just finding yourself wanting to please the Lord. Whether it is in the sound booth, whether it is vacuuming the carpet, hey, let everything that hath breath praise the Lord this morning, and you'll find yourself in the perfect will of God. You might be a soloist, you just might be up there singing in the choir. It's the will of God because you're pleasing Him with your life. And so in Ecclesiastes, we find that he concludes this right here. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter for God and keep His commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God shall bring every work into judgment and every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. So we find in Ecclesiastes, I just brought it all down to you in one little ball and just threw it right there in your laps. Everything is vanities. What is vanities? Everything that's in chapter 3 that he lists. And what is all that? Well, you go ahead and read it later. But we find out that the only way to find a life that is full and not full of vanities is to find yourself in the will of God in chapter 12. And that's what the preacher had to say. But he goes on to say this. You're still in 3, I hope. He goes on to say, well, after he gives the whole list of emptiness, he says, what profit hath he that worketh in that wherein he laboreth? I have seen the travail which God hath given to the sons of men to be exercised in it. And I love this. You did not realize this morning that whenever you woke up, you're going to be sitting inside of this church. Man, you think this is a mess and messed up and everything else, but God looks down and He sees Ecclesiastes chapter 11 that He makes all things beautiful in His time. Hey, and He's still working. Amen. He says, He hath made everything beautiful in His time. Right. Was it in your time? Or was it in your time? Was it in y'all's time? Yeah, the whole time. It was in His time, in the palm of His hand.
that God is working things for our good, that God is in control, that God is doing, that God is stirring, and God is working, and God is building. And I don't know about you, but I found out in life that I don't want to be the one in charge of what God is doing, but I benefit a whole lot more when I let God go ahead and build what His plans are, and I just go ahead and lend my hands and just let Him go ahead and build. He said He's made all things beautiful in His time. Also, He has set the world in their heart so that no man can find out the work that God maketh from beginning to end. Now, I'll tell you something I found super neat about this. Let me break this verse, because, man, I love this verse is probably one of the most beautiful verses. You can cling to this verse. My goodness, go get you a T-shirt and print it on there and wear that thing around that He makes all things beautiful in His time. I learned life's messy and messed up. And I learned we go through some things in life that we never dreamed that we would ever go through, and this, that, and everything else. But also learned that God is full of grace and God is full of mercy. And if you just let God be God, that at the end of this thing, He can turn around and work it for your good, and it can be a beautiful thing that He's building in the process. I'll tell you what I've learned. He makes all things beautiful in His time. Also, He has set the world in their heart, so that no man can find the work that God maketh from beginning to the end. In other words, no man knows what God's building. And by the time he's done doing this work, and by the time He's done building this work, this beautiful work, it said no man knows what He's doing. That means you're fixing to blow their mind. The mind of the brethren. The mind of people that said you couldn't. The mind of the people said you wouldn't. The mind of the people said there ain't a chance. The mind of the people said they're going to wash out. The mind of the people that said, hey, there ain't no way that that's ever going to come to pass. But can I tell you that with each stroke of the brush, that there is a God with a paintbrush, that He's in control, and He's painting the picture. And no matter what everybody's telling you all around you, He's working on a beautiful portrait. Will you let Him have your life and make a beautiful painting out of it? I learned this, Chris, about Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verse 11, where He makes all things beautiful in His time. It means this, basically. God will work, listen to this, Bill. God will work all things out so that when it's over, there is no other way it could have turned out better. Can I tell you, I just turned 41 2 days ago. And man, I'm living a dream in my life. I'm loving God. I'm serving Him. I'm watching Him do things. I know there's people all around me say He's a mess. He's this. He's that. And everything else. You listen to some crazy preacher this morning. I decided to preach in my Hey Dudes this morning because they're super comfortable. I didn't wear my shiny one this morning, Corey. But I just thought I'm going to go worship the Lord and be comfortable while I'm doing it. And you just looking at somebody. I don't even know if I match this morning. I'm just a mess is really what I am. But I do know this, that man, I'll tell you what, that everything that I've had that happened in my life, that what you're seeing today, what you're seeing a product of is just grace. And I'm telling you, it had to happen this way. And if I tried to do it any other way, there's no way it could have turned out better. Hey, that all things are beautiful in His time. Now with that, I'm going to give you a simple point. That was my introduction. And so with that, somebody say praise the Lord. The house is looking nervous this morning. In finding that all things are beautiful in their time, and in finding that we don't want to get sidetracked with vanities and things like that, the Bible says, everything there is a season. And I couldn't help it. I'm going to try to give you something here, and then we'll be done, and we'll be going down the road. But in that season, Corey, I've learned this, that we're in a season right now of winter. And I got to looking, and I started watching at what was going on around us and what this season means and what this season represents. Sorry, I've got cough drops in my pocket, and ADD's kicking in. But in this season, I told you, I'm as messed up as some of y'all, trust me. That's why I feel so comfortable here. Y'all know what I mean? But
I see that in this winter season that we're in, and I look back, and how many of you hate wintertime? Raise your hand. Go ahead. It'll be honest. You hate? Chris hate? Everybody? There's a lot of people that hate it. But guess what? Guess what? It's just a season. Because come here in about a month or two, the weather's going to begin to change. These old short, dark, depressing days are going to start getting long. We're going to start getting more sun. And you're going to look back and say, well, it ain't that cold outside, Bill. Everything's fine. Everything's all right. And you ain't even going to put any thought to that season that you just came through. I was doing a little bit of studying about this season and what it represents, because it's not a very pretty season. If you ask me, until it snows, I mean, it's kind of ugly. You know what I mean? You walk outside and just, I mean, they just ain't much glory in going on in the trees, if you know what I mean. And I got to studying a little bit about trees and this season that they go through. But in the middle of a season, you see, we went in these lists that they gave us right here in chapter 3, the preacher did. He gives you A to Z, life to death, planting, and then plucking up and everything else. He gives you the A to B, but do you know in the middle of that, there's a season where things just seem to go dormant. Dormant, quiet, still, nothing moving around. And to be honest with you, every time you look around, you think it's it. You could go outside right now and there's no declaration of life on these trees at all. You could swear that they were all dead on the hillside. But can I tell you that in the middle of a cold season, in the middle whenever the sun doesn't seem to shine down on the tree as long as it normally does, In the middle of the darkest part of the year of that tree's life, in the middle of the coldest part of the year of that tree's life, in the middle of whenever it just seems like nothing's right, everything's wrong, we's dealing with black ice this morning, we don't know if it's going to be 65 tomorrow or if we're going to be facing a blizzard. Bless God, it's West Virginia weather. We're just at the whims of what is sent our way this morning. But can I tell you that we just have no idea that this time of year, it just seems crazy. I mean, and it just seems depressing. I can't tell you how many times, suicide rates are up during this time of year because they know that it's somehow the sunlight, less sunlight has an effect on people's emotions and people just can't take it, and so things are just through the roof and it just seems bad and it's cold. It seems like you can't ever get warm. It just seems like a terrible, terrible time of year. And here's a tree out on the mountainside. No sign of life. Oh, it looked alive just about a month or so ago. It had them colorful leaves out there and it was beautiful and everything's fine. And boy, it was just out there and we loved driving across and seeing them then and everything else because it was just looking like they were supposed to. But guess what? Now they're still standing out there and now you can't even tell if anything's going on inside of them. How do we make it through this life facing the vanities that we're going to face? Facing and the temptations that come with vanity. You know, the devil loves us walking through this life full of vanities. Because whenever we're walking through with this half-empty cup and he sees that there's all kinds of room, emptiness inside of that cup that he can do something with, he's going to try to shove things in our face. I'm going to tell you, just because you're in church this morning, it does not mean, I'm going to turn around and look this way, it does not mean that you're not susceptible to pornography. Just because you're in church this morning, it does not mean that you're not susceptible to find yourself in an adult relationship as a married individual that you should have never been caught up in. Just because you're inside of the church this morning does not mean that you're not susceptible to getting hooked on some kind of a drug, some kind of an opioid, some kind of an alcohol. Just because you're in church this morning, it doesn't mean that you're bulletproof from being suffering from some kind of a panic disorder or depression or anxiety. Just because you're in church this morning doesn't make you some kind of a super Christian. We're messed up people walking around with a half-empty glass
mess, and the devil's looking for something to throw in it to discourage us, to get us away from God this morning. How do we find ourselves at the end of our life saying, I worked for the Lord, I served the Lord, my life is full of joy, and He made a beautiful picture out of the whole thing after it was done? How do we find ourselves at the end of this life and our life still pleasing the Lord like it was intended to begin with? I'm going to tell you what it is. It's because in the dormant seasons of life, we've continued to just go ahead when we've had every chance to be able to be blown over by the wind. We have every chance to be frozen to death. We have every chance to go ahead and be knocked over by the storms of life and things like that. We're still standing on the side of the hill. And even though I might not be as pretty as I used to be and things all together in my life, I'm still here. Now, how does the tree still remain right there on the side of the wet hillside and don't slide down? How does it still remain there during frozen weather and not snap in two when everything else is freezing and breaking? How does the tree still stay? Because the life is still in it. You see, if that tree had no life, it would have been knocked over. The tree, and that season happens for a reason in that tree's life. We know what happens whenever bad snowstorms come too early and things like that, and these trees got leaves and everything else. By the time that heavy snow falls on them, it busts them and breaks them and everything else. But you got to stop for a minute. You got to thank God that you're in a season in life when it feels like that nobody's around you or anything else. This is the best time to praise the Lord, Bill. This is the best time because whenever you're there for a reason and everything has a purpose, because if you would have had everything going on at the time when the storm hit, surely it would have busted you and surely it would have broke you down. But it's all right to be in the valley. In the valley, go ahead and praise. In the valley, go ahead and worship. In the valley, go ahead and know that God is in control. He sees you. He sees the point A. He sees the point B. He knew the valley was going to be there, and He put it there for a reason. And it could have been very well that you had to lose some things in your life so it wouldn't bust you and break you up even more than what you felt like it was going to do, and shatter you to a million pieces. In the middle of this tree going through a dormant season, the reason why the leaves that are on that tree begin to fall off is because the sap and everything starts leaving out where it was bearing fruits and nuts and leaves and things like that. The sap begins to come back inside of the main part of that tree to help it survive through the darkest part, and it's going to know throughout that year. Amen. And so you start seeing the leaves change color, and we say, that's beautiful. But the tree knows, I've been through this before. I'm getting ready to face pain like I've never faced before. I'm getting ready to go through something that I don't want to go through again. But I know a tree talking to itself. How about that? I got an imagination like you wouldn't believe. That tree knows that it is time, and God put it inside of that tree to start taking everything that was there and start bringing it to the inside of it. And in the middle of that season, be still. Psalms 46 says, be still and know that I am God. It's not time to run your mouth. It's not time to vent on Facebook. It's not time to do this or anything else. It ain't even time to try to pay attention to Oprah or Dr. Phil or anybody else. It's time to rely on God. And He told me to shut up and know He is God and trust in Him to get me through. And I'm telling you that you'll start feeling those seasons, and you'll start shelling up, and you'll feel like this is going to kill me and destroy me. But greater is He that's in me than he that is in the world. And I can tell you this morning, you might feel like you was losing this. You might feel like you was losing that. But there is a loving God that's more real deep down inside of you this morning to the saved. There's a God that's more real to you this morning than everything that you thought you lost inside of the world. The only way that old tree that looks dead is going to be able to survive through the season and through a period of dormancy whenever everything that you thought was life on the outside is real, real on the inside in the middle of it. That tree will begin to take in. I don't know what you're dealing with this morning, but God give us some blessed things and some blessed hope and some blessed peace when He gave us. Now, you might be sitting back here and you say, you don't understand what I've lost. You don't understand what I've gone through. You don't understand what I've done. Well, did God give you a memory to remember those things? Well, He did, didn't He? And
And I'm sure you've faced some hard, broken season or something else like that in your life. And it wasn't too fun, was it? Not at all. But we're on the other side of this thing. Still worshiping, ain't we? Praise the Lord, I give you a high five, my hand's sweaty. God help. I'm telling you that God, now the difference between what you use your memory for, okay? The difference in what you use your memory for is going to be the difference between what makes you better and what makes you bitter. You can weaponize your memory with things that you've gone through, and it'll be a cancer deep down inside of your soul and make you so bitter at this, that, and everything else. Or down inside of your life, you can take that which is, we could take all them same memories that you have, and boy, you can turn them into something that makes you better. Amen. Makes you better. Here's how it works. Is whenever a memory, whenever we're out there and we've got this and all we can think about is what we're losing in life. Well, I'm going through this, I'm losing that. I'm going through this, I'm losing that. I'm going through this part and I'm getting ready and I'm losing that. And just like a tree begins to lose the fruit and the leaves and everything else. Everything that we would look around and we'd say, man, look at that, look at the apples, look at how pretty that tree is, look at this and look at that. Everything that we would declare is great about that tree is losing it and getting ready to lose it or it's lost it. But guess what? We can either do this, Bill, everything that we've lost, or Corey, everything we've lost, or everything that we've gone through, we can sit back and think about that, or we can do this. This is hard. This is hard. And I don't want to go through this. But all of this, I'm getting ready to go through a real tough season. I'm getting ready to go through a real bad season. But I'm telling you, God tells me if I trust in Him, that if I'll obey Him, that He's going to get me through this thing, and He's going to get me through a harsh, harsh, tough season. And all these things that are locked up inside of you, you can either let them make you bitter, and I'm telling you what, you ain't going to make it. You ain't going to make it. Or you can sit back and say, God did that. God did that. And you can take all those things, and in the middle of a season, whenever you want it to be blooming, you want to be this, all that life, and you feel like you've lost this, no, there's a great life then inside of you. And you can begin to worship deep down inside of your soul at what God has done. And I'm telling you what, God loves the heart of a child. Child that can go through a season in life and worship Him. If you're going to make it through dormant seasons in your life, number one, it's because we've learned how to worship God through the dark, deep, dark times to watch Him do something greater in our life. I'm telling you, in the middle of that dormancy, that thing that's locked up inside of you, that thing that's down deep inside of you, God will begin to stir that up inside of your soul. And He'll say, I can do it again. I don't care how far you've gone, I can do it again. I don't care what you've done, I can do it again. And God will begin to take that life that's locked up inside of you and cause you to have. So He'll cause you to be all stirred up inside of your heart. He'll cause you to have a positive thinking again. And in the middle of a deep, dark season, whenever you should be, because you're a peculiar person, see, because you should be falling to the side, cut up for firewood or whatever else it may be, God's done give you a thing called hope inside of your life. I'll tell you something else that He does, that tree does. His branches are still up, ain't he? In the middle of dormancy, he begins to worship as well. I'm telling you, in the middle of a place where you feel like that you can't get through, that is God going to hear my prayers? Is God going to speak to me? Is God going to use me again? It's quiet, it's cold, and everything else. You watch what God can do. He'll put a remembrance of a song in your heart. He'll put a remembrance of a verse inside of your heart. And in the middle of a deep, deep, dark time, you don't know where it comes from, but you're just glad to be saved because it's cold, it's dark, and it's bad. But you ain't in a alone because He's with you. I don't know about you, but in the times whenever I could have just fallen over and quit and give up and I could have just gave in, I'm glad that He was still inside of me, still working in my heart, still doing something for me. Not letting me give up, not letting me quit, not letting me give in, but saying, son, I have a purpose for you. Trust and believe in me. I learned it in the moment of that dormancy for that tree. Praise the Lord. That the worship will get you through. That not only in our dormancy that we deal with, the worship, but also the prayer that gets through. See, prayer is whenever we talk to God. You hear me? We talk to God. We say, God, I got this going on. I got that going on. God, help me. This is how you get through the dormant, cold seasons of life this morning. You pray to God. And sometimes you go pray and you ain't going to feel a thing. Sometimes you're going to try to pray and you can't get a word out. And sometimes you're going to pray and it feels like He's sitting right beside you. But can I tell you, dear child of God, if you're going to make it, it's because you didn't quit praying the whole time. So we make it through with our worship, we make it through with our prayer, but we also make it through with reading our Bible. Because praying's whenever we talk to Him. But that Bible's whenever He comes down and He talks to us. And communication begins. You don't understand. You're seeing somebody this morning. I ain't trying to toot my own horn or blow my own horn. But this is stuff I had to try to live through and practice through. And I'm standing here still preaching the Word of God today because I learned, I read the Word of God and I listened to the old preachers tell me, if you're going to make it, it's because you stay in the book. If you're going to make it, it's because you pray. If you're going to make it, it's because you still worship Him. If you're going to make it, it's because you still try to please Him with your life, because it's some empty places in your life the devil's going to try to fill up with some bad stuff. So in the middle of that season, that dormant season, we're going to make it through because we pray, we read our Bible, and we worship. And let me tell you, this is something neat that I never did know before. But you know that stuff that you lost, that you felt like was great stuff and everything else? You know that tree, whenever it's up there, and that old ugly tree that we look at on the bank up there now, and it ain't got no leaves? Y'all going to be paying attention to the trees on the way home now, ain't you? You going to say, and you know what? Hey, praise the Lord. You know what we're going to do on our way home today? We're going to look up at that old bare tree. You're going to say, that's the most beautiful I've ever seen you. Because I can relate to where you're at right now. That tree loses all its leaves. And it looks like it ain't worth nothing. It ain't got no value or anything else. But did you know that them leaves, when they fall on the ground, and see, we usually just bag them up, throw them on the side of the street, burn them, whatever you do, you know. Did you know that whenever they fall to the ground, that the bugs and that the worms and everything else, it takes a little while, but they'll take and they'll chew them leaves up, and them leaves go to make, clean this up a little bit. They go to make, and the bugs and the worms and stuff, they make compost. Do I need to go any farther on the definition of compost? Everybody said no. Go move on, preacher. And you know what happens? Is those things that you felt like you lost in your life, you lost them, but you know what? You couldn't be surviving if you didn't lose them like that. Because what they're doing is they turn everything that you're planted in, everything that you're growing, and everything else, that all that stuff, the leaves and the fruit and everything else, and the nuts and the hulls and the shells and everything that tree lost that made it feel like it was what it was, didn't make it what it was. What made it a tree is exactly what's inside of it is what makes it the kind of tree that it is. Okay, you understand that? But we find that now that all of that stuff that it used to have went back into the ground and made the ground even richer and even better for it. So now whenever that tree goes to lose its leaf, you know what it does? It don't mind. Because number one, it's just a season. But number two, I know that I'm losing this, but in the end, I'm going to grow bigger. I'm going to be better. I'm going to do a whole lot better, because this is what has to take place in this season in order for me to grow, in order for me to produce more, in order for me to be more better, is I've got to lose this, because all this stuff the Bible done declared to me that all of it works to good for the good of them who love the Lord. And so in this, all this stuff that you're losing is just recycling to make you a better person and a better individual, so that you're a better testimony, you're a better witness. God's able to use you greater. God's able to build you better. God's able to do some things in your life that you was never able to do before. Go ahead and just shake them off. Lose them and say, it's going to be all right, because I'm held in the palm of God's hand this morning. I'm going to be better for the Lord. I'm going to be greater for the Lord. I'm going to be more than I ever dreamed I could be. All because I may look like I'm in a dormant season where ain't nothing going on, but you don't know everything that's coming down inside of me right now. The God that's inside of me, I'm just as alive today as I was with my leaves. I'm just alive today as I was when I started growing leaves again. I'm just as alive today in this dormant season as I've ever been. Other people might be fooled, but don't let you get fooled. Don't let you fall for it. Because I'm telling you that in the middle of that season, whenever you feel like you've lost everything, those things are coming back. Those things are going to be coming back to produce you into a better, better person. The brokenness that you learned how to endure for the glory of God,
You know why that you ain't bitter and drunk and laying home on the couch this morning? Because you went through that thing, or you ain't this or that, or you didn't fall back into that old lifestyle? Because God is great. And He turned that thing that was meant to break you again, that vanity, that empty place in your life that the devil tried to put it back in your place and tried to break you and bust you up again and tried to get you to where you wasn't no good. Oh no. God used that and recycled that back in your life to make you bigger and better than you ever was before. I say we ought to turn around and say, thank God for the seasons in our life, the dormant seasons in our life. Because for those seasons where I looked like where I was dormant, where it looked like I wasn't doing much, God was doing a great work that I couldn't see. And the Bible goes on to say this, and then we're going to be done. The Bible goes on to say this in the last part of chapter 3. He said, who, 21, chapter 3 and 21, who knoweth the spirit of man that goeth upward and the spirit of the beast that goeth downward toward earth? Wherefore I perceive that there is nothing better than that a man should rejoice in his own works, for that is his portion. For who shall bring him to see what shall be after him? The people around us do not know what God is working. But deep down inside of your heart this morning, look here, I'm done. Deep down inside of your heart this morning, you keep believing and you keep trusting that God's going to work a great thing in your life. Because I'm telling you this for a fact, that the Bible gave us promise after promise that He's going to work it in your favor if you trust Him. He's going to work it for you good if you trust Him. As long as you keep believing in Him and trusting in Him, keep on worshiping Him, keep on praying to Him, keep on reading your Bible, seeing what He's got to say to you, He is going to turn around. He's going to work this thing for your good. He's painting a beautiful picture. And the last thing we need to do is get our paintbrush out and our paints and think, we're going to do God. And whenever you do that, you're saying, God, I can do this better than you can. But I'm telling you, He works all things for our good this morning. Will you let Him take your life and make a beautiful portrait? Let's all stand together, every head bowed and every eye closed. Every head bowed and every eye closed. I don't know what you're going through in life. I don't know what you have going on in life. But I can tell you this. I know that every child of God goes through a season in their life of dormancy where they wonder, man, I don't feel like I'm where I was at or what was going on or this or that or anything else. Child of God, don't give up. Child of God, don't quit. Man, if we could just sit back and see the beautiful picture that He's painting, we're on the canvas. We can't see everything around us. But if we had a 1,000-foot view at what He's doing, we'd be like, God, do it again. Do it again, do it again. God, if it breaks me, do it again. God, if it messes me up that bad, do it again. God, if it does this, if it does that, I'm telling you from my point of view, from my life and where I've been, I couldn't have done anything any better than what God has done for me in my life this morning. And I'm telling you, if it took that to get to where I'm at again, and God, you know what I'm going through. God, you know what I've had to go through. God, I guess just go ahead and break me again because you made it pretty good. And you made it pretty good for me, God. You've done it. Thank you, God. How many of you be out there and say, I want to trust Him. I don't want to give up. I don't want Him to fill my life full of some of the empty places in my life full of stuff. The devil is full of stuff that's going to mess me up. Would you slip your hand up? There's hands all around. And why don't we come around here and pray together? Let's pray and encourage each other. Say, God, strengthen me. God, help me. Come on up. Come on up. You had your hand up. That means God may have been doing a little something in your heart, in your life, to strengthen you this morning. Would you come on up? Maybe you're out there this morning. Maybe you're out there this morning. And your life is empty. Amen. There's some right there. Your life is empty. Your life is broken. You can't get anything to make sense. As a matter of fact, when you start trying to think about the Lord and everything else inside of your life, you start thinking about the Lord, you actually can't even go back and pinpoint to a time in your life where you asked Him into your heart, where you stopped and you asked the Lord to save you. That's the reason why so much craziness is going on maybe inside of your life this morning, because you've never had God inside of your life taking everything and changing it around and painting that beautiful portrait that it was meant to be the whole time. Maybe you're out there this morning and your life is empty.
Maybe your life is empty because you don't know God as your Savior. Ain't nobody looking around. I want to pray for you. Would you slip up your hand and say, "Preacher, pray for me." Amen. There's one right there. I need a man to come up and pray with him, lead him through the Bible. There's one right there saying, "I want to get saved. I want to ask the Lord to save." Is there somebody else? Say, "Preacher, I'm tired of the emptiness that I have down inside of my life. I'm tired. I'm slipping up my hand. I want you to pray for me. Preacher, pray for me. I want to get saved." Anybody else? Church, pray. There's some up here around the altar praying right now for strength. Some praying to get saved. God, touch us and God, help us.
Fightings and fears within, without, O Lamb of God, I come. I come.
Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the service we've had this morning, God, and how blessed we are. God, it's been amazing. We pray that we never lose sight of the seasons that we're in. Every season, every change you've ordained, you've put in motion. God, you said you have an expected end, a desired destination. And Lord, we don't know where that may be and what kind of blessings that might hold, but God, we just excited you let us have a promise for tomorrow. Lord, we pray that you'd encourage and help us through the day. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, before I turn you loose, just want to say thank you for coming. Happy Truthiversary. I like to say that. If you're here today and you got any questions, concerns, anything you'd like to talk to us about, brother. One second, brother Daniel will be up here. Me and Chris will be back here changing shortly. But we got a book up here, has information about the church, about salvation, about all those things. We are going to have a baptism service. Exciting, amen. Getting ready to start that. I'm gonna go back and change. You can go ahead and you already changed. You ready to go? All right, that's what I'm talking about. Titus, what did you want, Bubba? You just reminded me. You the man. All right. If all hearts and minds are clear, we're dismissed. Stick around for the baptism service.